So I'm Dr. Greg Church. I'm the County Extension Agent for Horticulture here in Collin County. So we're going to talk about fruit gardening today. Pomology is the study of fruit production. So here are the topics we're going to cover today. Fruits for North Texas, basic biology, fruit trees and berries, tips for successful fruit gardening, varieties, and a big part of fruit gardening is pruning and training, and we'll talk about tools and pruning methods. So here's a list of fruit that can be grown throughout Texas. But as you can imagine, Texas is made up of a variety of different climates, from South Texas to the Panhandle, from East Texas to West Texas, are big extremes. And so there are limitations on what we can grow. So here's a little bit shorter list of things that can be grown in North Texas. And then it gets a little shorter in adding the word easy. So so there are some things on this previous list that probably don't work out so well, but you could try them. There are limitations because of our climate. Climate is a big limitation that is risk to being able to grow these crops. Or the fruit quality is just not as good. So that's why they're grown in different areas of the country, because they have the appropriate climate for it. There's also soil limitations as well. So this is the shorter list. That's not a bad list. They are beautiful fruit that we can eat. You know, it's worth giving it a try. So let's talk about the biology, because I think it's important to talk about the fundamentals of growing plants and understanding what they need, why they need it, and how to be the most successful with it. Starting off with, what are their requirements? These are the basic things they need. They need sunlight, water, air, temperature, I should say appropriate temperature, and a fertile soil. How does this all work? Well, photosynthesis is the process of capturing sunlight energy and converting it to sugars. And sugars, they're kind of the basic building blocks of the plant. But for our purpose today, we're talking about fruit. And so basically, fruits are full of sugar. That's why we like to eat them, because they're sweet. And so you have to keep in mind the leaves are capturing that sunlight energy and converting it to sugars. And when we talk about training and pruning, that's a big aspect of being able to be as productive and as efficient as possible, because we're trying to allow the plant to grow in a manner that captures as much sunlight and successfully grows that fruit. Another important thing is water. As we know, with the extended drought that we've been in, water is really important. When rain is not provided, we have to supplement that. And so an important part of water is drainage. We don't want the soil saturated with water. Plant roots need oxygen as well. And when all the pore spaces of the soil are filled up with water, there's no air in the soil. And so the roots can't breathe, and they stop functioning. When you're planting a fruit tree or any other type of plant, you really need to dig the hole, fill it up with water, and make sure it drains properly. A general rule of thumb, or the upper limit of drainage, is if you fill up the hole with water, it should drain within 24 hours, or it doesn't have sufficient drainage. And you might want to pick a different site, or try to raise up the soil so that you create a raised bed to overcome that drainage issue. Obviously, you would want probably better drainage than 24 hours, but that's the upper limit. Another aspect of water, considering this is a sustainable landscape lecture series, we want to conserve water. So what's the best way to apply that water? If you're using an irrigation system, some type of low volume irrigation or drip irrigation is the best way to do that. It applies the water directly to the soil in a slow manner, so that the soil can absorb the water. And when you think of trees have an extensive root system that goes very deep, and we want to water deeply so that the root system can attain that water. Our soil, because it's a heavy clay soil, the pore spaces are very small, and the water doesn't want to go in the soil pore spaces very quickly. So we have to apply the water slowly so that it can soak down into the soil. If you think about your sprinkler systems, they put out the water very rapidly, and often it runs off the top of the soil because it's coming on too fast. That's why they encourage you to use a cycle and soak feature, because you put a little bit of water on, then come back later in that cycle and put more. You can do the same thing with trees as well. Another important aspect of the biology of plants is the soil. We do have a very fertile soil, holds on to nutrients well, it holds on to water well, but often we want to try to improve the soil so that it's better for the plants. In this particular picture on the top left, we show an example of creating a raised bed for a small fruit tree. So that's possible for some of the fruits, especially our berries. You're going to probably want to do that. The general recommendation by Texas A&M Horticulture is to plant in your native soil because that when you dig a hole and if you just pack it in with potting mix or some other type of soil, the roots are going to want to stay in that hole that you dug and not move out from it. And so if we plant it in the native soil, the roots will extend out into that soil. And we'll talk a little more about how to plant a fruit tree here in a second. If you're going to improve your soil, you can build a raised bed. In this picture, we see a raised bed with sand. Generally, I don't try to encourage people to use sand with our clay because they don't really interact well. Often people do it because they think it's going to improve their soil. The only crop that I would suggest using sand, if you're going to do this, would be blueberries. Blueberries are a popular fruit to eat, but they require acidic soil, and we have an alkaline soil. And typically our pH is around 7.5, and a blueberry needs about 4. to 5 pH. So sand inherently is going to be more acidic, and so if you're going to grow blueberries, which I don't really recommend because of our soil, but if you're going to try it, build a raised bed or container to put them in. So we can use amendments such as compost, expanded shell, and till that into our soil to improve it, to improve that drainage. Here in this example, we have blackberries, and there's a raised bed, and they've improved the soil, and that's one way to do that. I highly encourage the use of mulch. Here's a long list of benefits that mulch provides, and I might as well spend a few moments talking about it because it is very important. Obviously, it can save a lot of water by conserving soil moisture. It reduces that evaporation from the soil surface and improves the ability of the soil to hold on to that water and make it available to the plants. It prevents erosion. Most people use it to prevent weeds, so they don't have to dig up weeds or they don't have to spray them with herbicides. That's misspelled there, but regulates soil temperature. Means it moderates it. It keeps it from getting too high or too low. So during the winter, it protects the plant roots so they don't get too cold and die. And then during the summer, it keeps them from getting too hot. When we think about plant roots, when they get too hot, remember they need oxygen too. And that the reason they need oxygen is because they go through respiration. Respiration is the utilization of chemical energy. We respire just like plant roots do. And so when the temperature goes up, they're going to utilize more energy more rapidly, and they're going to use up that stored energy that they have available to them, and it's going to cause them to become more stressed. So any of your plants, if you can use mulch, you're going to reduce the stress on them. And when we think about disease and insects, they're attracted to plants that are stressed or weak. And so they're going to be more susceptible to those problems. So we can prevent a lot of diseases and insects by utilizing mulch to prevent that stress. If we're going to increase the organic matter of soil by adding compost, we can maintain the level of organic matter in the soil by this mulch breaking down over time and enriching the soil with nutrients, encouraging beneficial microorganisms in the soil, etc. And that's related to soil health. That's where the soil is operating properly. It has the right microorganisms, the right nutrient levels, etc. You can use mulch in containers. It does prevent you from having to water as frequently because you don't have that evaporation from the top of the containers. Really, all gardening, all plants, they need to have mulch. If you could mulch a lawn, that would be great too. But that would look a little funny, wouldn't it? We recommend 3 inches, really, for all plants to provide all these benefits. I believe through our research that if you go less than that, you start not having all these benefits. So planting a fruit tree, since we're on the topic of soil and mulch, let's talk a little bit about how you'd plant a fruit tree. And you can apply this to berries as well. You can get them in containers or even bare rooted. A lot of the nurseries who are traditionally mail order catalogs, they can save on shipping if they don't send you the soil. And so that's the idea behind bare rooted. If they're packed properly, it's okay. And that's how they come. And so if you're buying blackberries, it would be very similar situation where they're wrapped up. Basically, you can plant through the winter, fall to winter. For fruit trees or any of these, it's better to plant during the dormant season than when they're actively growing, because they'll establish more quickly, because the plant will start to grow roots before the leaves start to grow, and it'll get established more quickly. So we dig a hole. We want to dig that hole to be sufficient size to accommodate that root system. So for this particular bare-rooted plant, it has a pretty significant root system, so we want to make that hole just as wide. We don't want to make a small hole and try to cram all those roots in there. We want them to be able to lay properly in there without being curved or bound. Because if you put a smaller hole, we'll put this in a smaller hole and then turn the roots around, it would start to circle in that hole, and then they would eventually girdle the plant, where they basically it chokes itself from the bottom. And some of our landscape trees, especially our maples, if you drive around and look at them like I do, you'll see these roots that are up at the top of the soil surface around the base of the plant, and they'll start circling around there, and it'll eventually kill the plant. In a container, same sort of recommendations. You want to make that hole really twice as wide or even three times as wide as that container. And so that's indicated here in the picture. And then you set that root ball at or above the depth that it is in the pot. So you don't want to plant it too deep, and that's a very common problem. Normally, I plant it a couple of inches higher than the soil around it. Because that you've dug this hole, and generally all the soil will settle, and so you don't want to plant it at the same level because it might settle too deep. Going out and visiting different orchards here in the county, that's a common problem where they're planting it just too deep. The plant might look okay for now, but it's later on down the road they're going to start to have problems. This shows how they're watering to fill this hole up after planting. That's really important because you want to settle the soil. The water helps to settle it. You don't want air pockets in the soil because as those roots grow, when they hit an air pocket, it'll dry out that root tip and it'll stop growing. This shows how to properly mulch around the tree. You basically want a donut around the tree. That's basically how you do it because you don't want that mulch up against the base of the tree because it'll promote rotting of the bark and eventually kill the tree. So another important aspect of biology, especially with fruits, is temperature. At least two aspects of temperature are involved. That's cold hardiness, so it's ability of the plant to survive extreme low temperatures. And so we use the USDA hardiness zone, but it's based on the average annual extreme minimum temperature. And then there's another aspect of fruits is chilling requirements. We also call it chill hours. Basically, it's the time or hours between 32 degrees Fahrenheit and 45 degrees Fahrenheit from October to February. You get the most impact of the temperature when it's between 32 and 45. Climate can be the biggest risk, and in certain crops it's even riskier. For example, peaches, oftentimes when you plant the wrong variety that doesn't have the appropriate chill hours for our region, they will bloom too early, then we'll get a late freeze, and then you lose the crop. So basically, if you have a peach tree or other type of fruit tree and you never get a crop, it could be because it blooms too early. Here's a map of chill hours across the state of Texas. So we have from 100 to 2 hours all the way up to 1,000. So we have a big difference across the state. We're unfortunately right on the line, so you really don't know exactly how many hours we have, but we're between 800 and 1,000, which is a pretty big range. So if you're in the vicinity of either one of those, that's a safe bet. It kind of reverts to soil temperature, determines when they leaf out in the spring. But like peaches, they'll bloom early and they get froze out. So it depends on the crop. And I won't spend a lot of time talking about that, but if you're gonna grow some of these, use the recommended variety list, or if you're gonna try something new, check on the details of that particular crop. You can find this online through USDA. They updated it recently, and so they've changed our zone. Now we're just all 8A. And if you look at the chart, let's see, 8A is 10 to 15 degrees. So that's kind of the range of extreme temperatures we're gonna get. And actually, lately, we've been getting 10 degrees every year. So we have to have plants that are gonna survive that. I'll go through a couple slides of tips. This is mainly focused on proper kind of planning. And so you gotta pick the proper site, make sure you have enough space for the plant, and make sure you understand how big those plants are gonna get and how much pruning you could do on those and still stay within your space. You should test your soil, not only taking a soil sample and send it to the lab for analysis, but determine your type of soil. We generally have 7.5 to 8.5 pH range. But if you have a soil test done, it'll tell you that as well. Weather has good drainage, so dig that hole, fill it up with water, see how long it takes to drain. Proper watering is important. I say the Goldilocks principle, it's not too much and not too little. You want to be just right. A lot of plant problems are based on watering. Make sure you provide full sun. Most of these plants are not going to be shade tolerant. They got to have full sun, which is an extremely limiting factor in a typical residential neighborhood with a quarter acre lot. If you already have trees in the backyard, especially if you're doing it in the backyard, there's going to be very limited space for full sun. So you got to make sure you provide that light requirement. And then any other specific requirements of that crop. Continuing on, select the appropriate crop and variety that does well for our specific soil and climate. And make sure you purchase quality plants from a reputable nursery. Oftentimes, a nursery, I'm not pointing out any names, but a lot of their plants aren't really for our area. And so oftentimes, I get calls, what's wrong with my fruit tree? I never get a crop. It always gets frozen out, or we lose the crop because of a late freeze. And so what's wrong? Ask what variety they have, and they don't know. And they say, oh, I got it at such and such place. And they'll say, well, they don't really carry the appropriate trees for our area. So check that out. Don't plant too deep. I think I mentioned that enough, that if you plant too deep, you're going to start with problems right away. Prevent disease and insect problems before they occur, because you don't want to have to go out and spray a lot of pesticides. And some of these crops, if you want to be worm-free and disease-free, you're going to have to spray on a spray cycle, just to prevent those. If you don't mind that so much, you can just pick the ones that are free of those, and that's what you get, and that gives you confidence you don't have any pesticides that you're applying on these. Like peaches are a perfect example. They are gonna get worms, or they're gonna get some fungal diseases, and really the only way you can prevent those is gonna be spraying a protective spray on those before the insect comes in or before the disease comes in. Use hardwood mulch around the trees, extend it out to the drip line of the tree. And then another important factor is realize these are generally short-lived plants and they won't live forever. And so like a peach tree is an example that you're lucky if it gets to 10 years old. And so it's gonna be something where you're gonna plant it, get as many years out of it as you can, and then replant. So if you know that up front, it makes it easier in accepting it down the road. The reason why some of our trees don't live as long is because of some of the insects and diseases that end up killing the plant. So variety selection, that's a key component to being successful. Learn as much as possible about the specific crop. A great way to start doing that is by going to this website, aggiehorticulture.tamu.edu. That's the website for the Extension Horticulture for the state of Texas. On that site, there's a link for fruit and nut resources. Starts with apples, avocados, and goes down through all the different crops that we can grow here in Texas. So click on it, it'll pull up a publication, and it has a lot of information that's really important before you get started to make sure you plan that out. So start with learning as much as possible. Another important aspect is, where can I get it? And so you gotta check to make sure it's available, because as you're planning out your fruit garden, you're gonna have to make sure, one, that's recommended, and two, it's available. You know, we have some great fruit tree nurseries that sell all these types of plants that we're talking about today. Here in the state of Texas, but some of the crops, you can buy those out of state if they're not locally available in Texas or at a local nursery. In the process of placing your order, make sure that you double check that it has the right chill hours for our area. Some of those catalogs will actually tell you what chill hours are necessary for that crop, and make sure it's adapted to our soil. I'll spend a few moments just talking about the different plants. Blackberries, that's a very easy crop to grow, has very few problems. Probably the most common problem you'll see is iron deficiency. Because our pH is so high, iron becomes less available at the higher pH. And pH is acidity and alkalinity, so we're alkaline and it's less available. These varieties are developed at the University of Arkansas, and they're great varieties. They have some thornless and thorned varieties. If you don't like the thorns, which most people don't, you can start with those. It makes it easier to harvest and prune, but some people obviously think, well, you don't have the same flavor. But it is a great way to start if you're going to grow blackberries. And blackberries, we'll talk briefly, but I have some in my backyard. And they're a little maintenance because they want to just spread and ramble all over the yard. And so they'll start popping up everywhere because they'll grow under the ground as a rhizome and then start popping up. So you have to go, if you want to keep it contained, you have to go out there and dig it up. Figs, we can grow figs here. Here's three varieties. It's Texas Everbearing is a very popular variety. It's also called Brown Turkey. They have very few problems also, so it's a great crop to start with. It generally grows kind of a small tree or bush, depending on how you prune it. Pears, we have European hybrids and Asian varieties. Here's the recommended varieties for North and East Texas. I've had a lot of pears where you don't have to spray anything. They might look ugly, but they taste great. You know, it's only skin deep. You can always just scrape, you know, the skin off, so. That's not too bad. So you might check these out and try to grow them. Grapes, these are some varieties that do well. They're more the French American hybrids or other types of hybrids, so they're not your Vitis vinifera, the European grapes. Reason why we don't have that on the list, even though we do grow them here, is they do have a lot of disease and insect problems that you have to deal with. These are more less maintenance. And they're more table grapes too. But any table grape you can make wine out of. And we do have some local suppliers of kits and supplies for making your own wine from all these fruits. You don't have to make wine just from grapes. You can make it from all sorts of fruits. Pecans, they're native to Texas and the Southeast. So we have a lot of native varieties. I focus just on the improved pecan varieties. Desirable is a long time recommended variety for landscapes just because of the traits that it has. It's just more suitable for landscapes. And you'll notice that I have a one and a one and a two. Well, in pecans, you need two varieties, one variety to pollinate the other. And so you have to have a one matched up with a two. Generally, if you have pecans within a mile radius of your location, that'll sufficiently wind pollinate that tree, so it's all wind pollinated. So you can plant one variety and you'll probably get sufficient pollination, but if you're concerned about the most productivity that possible, it's best to put a 1 and a 2 together next to each other. And a good match for that is Pawnee and Kanza. Those are the latest recommendations of varieties. Peaches. So here's three top recommended varieties for more of the home fruit garden. These are about 750 chill hours, and so that's fairly close to our chill hour requirements. Plums. Morris is a high chill hour that's matched. It's 800. It does work better if you have another variety to go with it. And I was trying to do some research on which variety to go with it. I don't have a good answer. So try to find a variety that has matched chill hours. You can read the publication that's on Aggie Horticulture to get a better feel for that. And it'll probably indicate that there is quite a bit of risk involved in plums. So I just want to throw that up there as far as varieties. Persimmons, we do have a native Texas persimmons, although the fruit is not what most people desire. So you can grow the native persimmons, but they're very astringent. So if you pick them too early and they're not ripe, when you put them in your mouth, it basically feels like your mouth just turned completely dry. And it's just like, ooh. So the general rule is you have to wait till all the leaves have fallen and the fruit falls on its own from the tree before it's even remotely edible. I've picked up some in the parks around the area and picked them up and tried to eat them. And even with no leaves and ripe and falling off, it's still pretty bad. Pomegranates, I mentioned they do have some limitations on cold tolerance here. So they're about 10 to 15. These are varieties with a good cold tolerance. Raspberries, Dorma Red is the recommended variety. You're gonna grow them like blackberries. They generally prefer to have a trellis and that you train them up a trellis. We'll show you that in a little bit, but that's Dorma Red is the recommended variety. Strawberries, here's the recommended varieties, and you're gonna grow those more like a vegetable, in a vegetable type garden. Okay, pruning and training. The whole point of this is to get the most productivity, make it easier to harvest, helps with sunlight penetration, size control, fruit load management. So some of these trees, like peach trees especially, you have to manage the weight of the fruit because it can be so heavy it can break the tree. So we want to encourage proper branching for strength. We also manage vigor, so it's not too much vegetative leaf production that it also puts energy into the fruit too. We also reduce the occurrence of injury by pruning and training. We can increase airflow through the plant to dry out the leaves so you don't have as much diseases on your fruit and leaves. And then you can remove disease branches from the tree by doing pruning and training. So I pulled out some quotes that I found on the internet from experts about just the concept of pruning and training, because it's oftentimes hard for people to understand why are we doing this. And so it makes it challenging and also intimidating at the same time. Let's read through some of these. So it's the science of pruning a tree means you're aware of how light affects its growth and how its structure develops over time. And so understanding that when you're out there with your loppers and you're making a pruning cut, you're thinking that about all this because you understand how it works. And so each pruning cut, you have to make a decision. And that decision should be influenced by knowledge of how the plant grows. We aim for a tree that's well-balanced between growth and production, easy to manage, and open to light and air. And then think of it as a living sculpture with many light channels that flow through that structure. So tools for pruning, there's a lot of different pruning tools, from a chainsaw to hand shears or clippers. You have saws and all sorts of things. Probably the most common thing that I use is your standard lopper. So that's the most versatile thing. It always is nice to have the little hand shears too. And this picture gives you an indication of you want to match the tool for the job. And it's determined by the size of the stem that you're cutting. You don't want to overtax your tool because it'll break or damage it. And you want to keep your tools very sharp too because it makes it easier to cut. The other thing is sanitation of your tools so you don't transmit diseases between plants. You can use alcohol, like rubbing alcohol, a 10% solution of bleach. And then the latest recommendation is just like a antimicrobial type spray. I have some people using the Lysol kitchen wipes, the you know, you pull out of this tub and you can wipe it off. So that's something else. At the very least, do it between plants, even your landscape plants, if you're pruning shrubs, roses, etc. So if you're making big cuts, we recommend the three-cut method, where the first cut occurs right here, and it's an undercut. You only make it a little bit in, probably an eighth to a quarter inch into the bottom of that limb. Then you make your second cut here, all the way through. And why is that? Because the weight of this limb's coming out here, and if you don't make that cut right there, it's gonna rip down all the way down the tree and damage the tree, you'll cause a wound that's not gonna heal properly, and it's gonna promote disease and insects to come in there. You'll come back a third cut and cut around the collar of the tree. Not all collars are as clear as this picture indicates, but you basically want to make a cut at an angle, not straight down, but at an angle, so that this tissue is designed to heal that area, and it'll eventually cover it up and you won't ever see it. So that's a good clean cut, doesn't promote any diseases or insects. So when we think about pruning, when we make certain pruning cuts, we promote different growth. And so this is on an alternate, where the leaves alternate between where they connect to the stem. If we make a cut right there at the top, we promote branches to come off. So you see all these buds here, well, you'll promote those buds to break and start a new stem. And so when we make certain pruning cuts, we are encouraging different growth patterns. Just another idea, if they're opposite leaf arrangement, you make a pruning cut, it's gonna start these buds to break. Let's spend a few moments talking about the different pruning and training systems. So we have open center, a very common method, and then central leader is the next common method. Then these other ones are modified central leader, fruit bush, trellis, cane spur, cordon, that applies to grapes, thin center, and then the other specific methods for your crop. So here's some examples of those pruning and training systems. This is the open center with the peach tree. This is gonna be more of your bush or hedgerow. This is the grapes, where you have a trellised cordon type system, which is pretty traditional in a vineyard. And then this would be a central leader, where that central leader is just one stem going down this center. It's probably the most traditional method for any type of tree, is promoting that central growth or main stem. So here's a central leader and then a modified central leader. Modified central leader means they made a cut to promote more growth from a lower point. And then the open center, it's hard to depict in a two dimensions because it's more like a three dimensional. It's open center. If you were on top of the tree looking down, you could actually see the center of the trunk because you've kept the center of the tree open. Open center covers these crops, which are your stone fruits primarily. And then central leader covers these crops. And this is how you create a open center. Basically, you plant a stick, which is a hard thing to do for anybody. So that's what you plant. It comes like this, and then you cut it all off. That cut is about 2 feet off the ground, because when you're done, you want your trunk 2 feet off the ground. Then you create scaffolds in that tree. So the second year, this is what it looks like. It just looks pretty haphazard from there. And so you come in and start training and picking branches that are gonna develop into your scaffolds. Those are your main branches that come off the trunk. So you plant a stick, and that's what you end up with. So that's about 2 feet off the ground. Most people will ask, why is it whitewashed? A common problem with peach trees and a lot of fruit trees is sun scald. Having a whitewash on it helps reflect light and prevents the bark from getting too hot and damaging the tissue. So, but most often I see sun scald on these branches here. Assuming this is west over here and this is east, that sun, afternoon sunlight, penetrating that open center and hitting these branches, you're gonna have sun scald. Most often occur right here, where that tissue's heated up rapidly and actually kills it. So that's why we keep these little bitty branches through here to shade that, because those will have leaves and they'll shade and protect that branch. So when we go back to this, do you see how we're doing this? We're picking some of these main branches that come off our stick. We pick approximately 4 scaffolds or branches, and we promote those as we prune into the shape. It's better if they come out at a certain angle, but sometimes we can't control that. And then they kind of grow up, and we want to get them to grow out like a vase, you know, grow out further like this to be open up to capture that sunlight energy. Also, if you look, we're kind of topping the tree too, and the height that I top, maybe not the same height that you top, because I'm about 6'2", and when I reach up with the loppers, that's about where I top the tree. Then when I go back to pick, I can reach the fruit. I don't have to get a ladder. I can just reach it. Keep in mind, the branches are going to hang down a little bit when they're loaded with fruit. And I'm focused on peaches, but this applies to a lot of those similar crops, those stone fruits. We're going to do it the same way. And these fruit trees, they bloom early spring, and that's the first thing to do is bloom. And so if you get a late freeze, you potentially could lose all the crop. And that's even with having different varieties, because they'll bloom at different times because they're responding to those chill hour requirements as they're met. So, but this also relates to pruning, because we're actually pruning off a lot of the fruit too when we prune. And so we're reducing the amount of fruit that plant's going to produce, which can be a good thing, because these trees are going to produce more fruit than they can support the weight. So we have to manage them so that they don't break themselves, so to speak. So that's what it'll look like. They have drip tubing down the middle. They keep it weed free to reduce competition, even though I really would rather have a good cover crop or mulch it, because this is increasing evaporation of the soil surface. It's not providing any benefit besides reduced competition. So here's your main trunk, about 2 to 3 feet off the ground, and then you have your scaffolds. And you can see that these branches are being shaded by some of these leaves here, so we're not getting any sunscald damage. And then this is a tree that hadn't been pruned recently or properly. This is basically an orchard that they'd abandoned, and so it just kept growing. And what happens with these trees is the fruit wood, which is the one-year-old wood, it was new growth last year, and so this year it's fruit wood, and so it'll bloom, and that's where your crop is. So as you can imagine, as a tree grows, that gets further out, and there's no chance you're going to climb that tree and pick it. So that's another reason why we prune, is because we want to keep that fruit wood down close to the ground that we can reach it. This picture back here gives you an example. If you're gonna go prune, you can always wait till you have the blossoms on your tree. Then you know how much fruit you're gonna be taking off. So central leader, or modified central leader, is for these crops. And this is a very intensely managed apple tree here. And this doesn't look very normal, does it? If you've grown any pears or apples, it doesn't naturally look like that. That's because it's been trained to grow like this, and it's been pruned too. A couple things I'll point out, and the reason why it's done this way, is sunlight penetration. Remember, that's a big component of the open center. Well, it's the same for this. The sunlight's not coming in directly down the center, it's coming in the sides. So these crops, particularly apples and pears, they're gonna wanna grow. A branch will come out here, and it'll grow kinda more parallel to that main central leader. That prevents sunlight getting into the branches of the tree. It reduces the quality of the fruit and the amount of production and sugars that can be formed. This is done in a manner like this. So you might buy the tree like this. You're gonna prune off these branches a certain way to promote this central leader. So here's another example of the process. So this is incorrect pruning. This shows how those branches grow more parallel to that central plant. We want to do it differently. We want to encourage growth outward so you have good sunlight penetration. If necessary, and normally it is for at least one of that first year of training, is to put these spacers in, and these basically are attached to the plant. You can make these yourself. You might use wire and PVC tubing, and you're basically wrapping it around the trunk, run the wire through a PVC tube, and then wrap it around, and you're pushing that branch to grow more horizontally. Not completely horizontal, but more horizontal instead of up like this, so you get better sunlight penetration. So thinning helps to increase the size of the plant and keeps it from breaking. So this is too many peaches here, and you don't want this. You can see that the branch attaches way up here, and it's curving way down here. And that's too much. It's going to break off, and you're not going to get any fruit. But you can imagine if you have a tree loaded up with that, the whole thing could collapse and break and kill the tree. And here's the rule of thumbs. Peaches, nectarines, every 4 to 6 inches, you can have one fruit. So you're taking out quite a bit. Apples, 1 to 2 per cluster. Apricots, 2 to 3 inches apart. Persimmons, 1 fruit per shoot. And then the other ones, no thinning required. Although commercial pecan producers, they actually have a machine that goes out and it shakes the entire tree. It's an attachment to the tractor, or it's a specific machine. And they'll vibrate the trunk of the tree and shake off some of the fruit to thin it. So this is what a typical fig would look like around here. It's more like a bush, and sometimes you have multiple stems. We just do light pruning to increase that sunlight into the canopy. Pretty easy, and there's not a big push on all this modified central leader and stuff. So you might see a big bush like this. For me, that's not pruned properly. We need to get some airflow in there and thin it out. That's just kind of overgrown. Same with the pomegranates, it's more like a bush. So this is not bad pruning. Some years you might try to take out some of these to get some airflow, but looks like these trees are producing some nice fruit. Grapes, this is one of the hardest things to prune, in my opinion, because there's such a science to the whole process. But I'll try to simplify it as much as possible. For a typical home gardener, you can follow these rules. The simple growth of the plant is that each year, a bud on the main cordon or stem of the plant, that one bud will produce a shoot, and it's gonna have 1 to 2 clusters of grapes. So your pruning helps to lighten the load by pruning it down, and I'll show you how severe it actually is. So we want to leave 10 to 14 buds on each side of that trunk. I'll show you a picture of what that means. As you're getting it started, basically the first couple years you don't do very much. We just leave a couple buds here. Those grow up, and we'll actually train it over time. You don't have to train it up a post, but you can train it up onto the wire if you have a trellis system. You can also grow these on arbors and stuff as well. This is the typical method of a two-wire trellis system. So we train it up and then train branches, we also call those arms, onto the wire. If you recall, it said one-year-old buds, so we have to save a certain number of one-year-old buds. These are last year's growth. You could actually use some of these buds, but generally we try to keep the buds right here on what we call the spurs. We'll keep these buds here and cut off all this other stuff. So generally in a vineyard, you can do this in your garden too, you just come through here and whack all the major stuff off and leave these little sticks sticking up. And then you come back in and you do the fine pruning without all that junk to deal with. You'll count 10 to 14 buds over here and 10 to 14 buds over here. Knowing what the buds look like is really important, so you know what to look for. It's not that difficult. A couple things to know about grapes is they have a tertiary bud, which means they basically have 3 buds in one. And the primary bud will initiate in the spring when the chill hours are met and the soil temperature's appropriate. It'll break that bud and send out a shoot that will already have the flowers on it. Because actually, within that bud, the flowers and the leaf tissue and stem is already developed. It's just microscopic. So in the spring, when it breaks that bud, it just fills all that up with water, and the cells divide and it gets bigger. And so it's already kind of preformed there. And there's 3 preformed buds, actually. So if the first one gets frozen out, it'll send up the second one. But the rule applies only to that primary bud. So you only get 1 to 2 fruit clusters for that first primary bud. The second bud, if it has to initiate after a freeze, it's going to probably only have 1 cluster, if that. The tertiary bud's not going to have any fruit on it at all. So the plant will still survive. You just lose that crop for that year. Does that make sense? So you understand you still have a backup there. It's part of our research is we're theorizing that covering the soil with mulch helps to delay the bud initiation or bud break in the spring. So it occurs after our late freezes. And so we're hoping that it protects you from those late freezes by, if we could get a few days or even a week delay, we're gonna capture or prevent a lot of damage to that tissue. So after we prune, this is what it might look like. Much different. And it's good to haul that material off and have it recycled in a compost pile and or even burned if you can do that and you're out of the city limits, because some of that tissue could have diseases on it. And remember, our benefit of pruning is taking out diseased tissue, so we can help prevent that. Here's some of my colleagues that took off the shoot that was developed, and it shows you got two clusters on there. So one bud, one shoot, one to two clusters. And a lot of these vines are very vigorous. So keep in mind, we've just had these little arms sticking out here, and all this growth has grown. And this is probably, I would guess, June or July of the year. And so we've trained it up onto the wire. You can't even see the wire in this picture, but pretty interesting. But not everybody's gonna put up a trellis system in their backyard. Here's an arbor that you could do. You're still gonna wanna prune this. If you don't prune it, it's not gonna be productive. So here's another method, or type of arbor that you can have it grow up, or trellis. So on some of the berry crops, like raspberries, we encourage you to use a trellis system to get the plant up off the ground, because it's gonna lay down more than a blackberry would. And so having a trellis is gonna encourage to capture more sunlight, have more airflow, et cetera. And you're gonna wanna just train it up on wires. If you go back to what I said earlier, blackberries, raspberries, they're biennial plants. And so what that means is you have, and I think I have a picture, they're biennial plants, so they grow atop, then they fruit the next year. Then that fruit cane dies, or fruit stem, it dies. So basically, you get 1 year of vegetative growth, that same stem turns into a fruiting stem, and it has flowers on it the second year. And then you get that production, and then it'll die that winter. And the pruning practice is cutting out those old canes that have died. That can be harder to do than you realize, but actually the canes turn a gray color, so the ones that are dead are pretty obvious which ones to cut out. Now, if you got a thorn variety, that's the hard part. So wear some long gloves, or at least long sleeve shirts, gloves, and use some loppers so you can get into that jungle, so to speak, and clean those out. And he's coming in here and pruning out those dead stems. This already has leaves on it, so you could wait till it leaves out in the spring so you know for sure which ones to prune out. Okay, here's blackberries. So this is one thing you can do. He has wires along the side. He's got T-posts kind of at a V, and it helps to contain the plant. You can try to train it up between those wires so it's not just laying on the ground. And this is a commercial fruit orchard, and they have trellised these into a hedgerow, and they come in and prune these off. At the peach orchard I worked at, we grew just a big patch, picked as much as we could out of there, and then every few years we'd just go mow the whole thing down, lose a year of production, but it'd clean it all up. And it saved us a lot of time from having to prune that stuff out. That's an easy method. You're just gonna lose a year of production. Raspberries look really similar, and you can grow it in a similar trellis system like that. When do these crops start bearing fruit? On some of these trees, it's quite old, but it's like 5 years. So 5 years for a pecan tree, 3 to 5 years for a lot of our fruit trees. For our berries, it's normally the second year. So like blackberries, they're a biennial plant, and they're gonna produce the second year. Raspberries, the same way. Strawberries, it's the same year. They're almost a perennial, but they won't last forever. But I will tell you, strawberries should be planted in the fall instead of the spring. Although when you go to shop for them, they're not available in the fall, they're available in the spring. So it's best to order those, probably on your own through a mail order, so you can get those planted in the fall. Some resources. I mentioned Aggie Horticulture. We also have a great website on wine grapes that has a lot of resources. The Noble Foundation I mentioned, Vegetable Fruit Improvement Center at Texas A&M. We have a bookstore, our website, the county extension website, and this is the Master Gardener website. encourage you to check out those resources for more information. Hopefully this was informative. Thanks for coming.